And so this is what we're looking at by taking a look at that contribution margin statement. It's separating variable costs from fixed costs. And that's a key to financial management strategy, where showing just a regular income statement is key to financial accounting, and showing your investors and showing the external users of your financial information what your profits are based on cost of goods, operating expenses. A very important concept. Now, let's look at the flip side of this. Budgeting. Okay, here's a problem in chapter 20 that pretty well summarizes the whole chapter. The good thing about this is you are not going to be asked to prepare any budgets, any calculations, anything. The key thing that I wanted to show you in this problem is the how detailed and how specific the budgeting process can be. And that's important. A lot of you in your jobs now probably work with a budget, especially if you're a department manager or any type of manager or responsibility manager, where you have a budget for your department or a budget for your division. What is a budget? It's a plan. It's a plan that you measure performance on. It's a plan that you measure success or failure in the operations and efficiency of your operation. So a budget is a plan. So as you can see, here's a company on problem 20-4 on page 445, on page 809, that gives a company's balance sheet as of March 31st, Zigbee Manufacturing. There's their actual financial statement balance sheet. You are asked in this problem, and you're not going to be doing this, but I'm going to run through the process to show you the different types of budgets there are, to prepare a master budget for the next 3 months, April, May, and June. All right. And it gives you all the details in this problem, what the sales are going to be in planned sales in units in April, May, and June. What's the raw materials? What are the inventory levels? What's the policy on overhead and cost, commissions, general and administrative expenses, all kinds of information, dividends, cash balances, equipment purchases. And so we're asked to prepare what is called a master budget, which is a series of budgets with all these specific areas in context. And it says prepare a sales budget, a production budget, a direct materials budget, and so on throughout this process. And that's what a master budget is. It's preparing all these levels of the company's business so you can use that as a plan. So let's take a look at that. Okay, here's the series of budgets for Zigbee Manufacturing. And I think of anything in financial management or financial strategies that a lot of you out there in your own careers know is the budget process. It's a series of planning steps from revenue to expense to cash management to all kinds of things that you put together to show the performance and use that as the actual numbers come in of whether you are planning correctly. Here's the sales budgets. We're planning 20,500 sales in April, 19,500 in May, and so on. There's our selling price. So those are our budgeted sales. Here's what we aim to produce. This is how many units we are going to plan on producing in those time periods. We have a budgeted sales. Remember, we had a beginning inventory already. So we end up how many units we have to produce. To meet these sales figures, we have to produce these amount of units. Because it's all driven by, this is what we want to sell, this is our inventory levels that we have to keep, and there's the amount of units we have to produce. That leads us into the direct materials budgets. If we need those many units, how many raw materials are we going to have to go and purchase and supply to provide the raw materials for those units we need to produce? And there's the cost of materials. That, how much is it going to take us to produce these number of units in labor? With 50.5 or a half hour per unit at our labor rate, pretty cheap, $15, that's minimum wage, it gives you our cost of labor. So now we've determined material costs, labor costs. Here's our overhead costs based on a predetermined overhead rate. Now we have all our production costs. So now we can go into what our selling expenses are. If we're going to sell this in dollars, it's 8% commissions, the salaries of our sales teams. Here's our selling expenses. Here's our G&A expenses, other administrative expenses. Here's the cash receipts from these sales. We estimate getting 30% of our sales in cash and collecting the balance through receivable, 70%. Here are the cash payments for materials. Here's the cash budget, our cash budget of cash receipts, our cash payments for materials, labor. Notice our preliminary cash balance. Looks good. We're going to pay back a loan. There's our ending cash balance. That starts out in May. Again, receipts, disbursements, boom. And so there's our cash balances throughout. Doesn't look like we have to borrow any money. We have positive cash balance, even though we are paying $12,000 in April. This is probably a quarterly payment. And there's our cash budgets. Here's our budgeted income statement. We're planning on making a profit of $48,867 in June. Sales, cost of goods, and so on. Here's our planned balance sheet. All these steps lead to this. And this is the bottom line. This is where you judge the performance of the company. Is our plan matching the actuals as they come in over these months? And that's called a variance analysis. But the budgeting process sets this up. And you can see it'll drive you crazy putting all this together. Steps after steps. And usually in most businesses, they have specific areas of the business that concentrate on this. The marketing department puts together the sales budgets. The production or the distribution or the manufacturing department puts together the production budget. The purchasing department usually puts together the materials budgets. The HR department usually puts together the labor budget. Factory overhead is usually provided by the accounting department. The expense budget is usually provided by the accounting department. So is the G&A, selling and G&A, or selling might be more marketing and G&A. The cash receipts provided by the controller or the treasurer's office. Same with cash payments. The cash budget by the treasurer's office. So you have all different segments of the company putting together these budgets. So everybody has a part of, a feel for, where we're going to in our plans for this company. And if the budgets have a negative variance, in other words, your budgets are off, that tells you a couple of things. Business is not what we thought it would be. And two, we're not very efficient. And three, is our budgeting process incorrect? These are part of the internal controls that result from this budgeting process. Very important to companies. So again, you don't have to worry about putting together a budget, but you have to worry about why budgeting is so important for a business. Without it, we can't judge our performance. We can't judge if we're doing a good job or not. They come to a net income of $48,867 because they know they need to make a profit so they can distribute some of that in dividends to their investors. Remember back in the cash budget here, notice they're planning on paying dividends in the month of May. They're not going to pay any dividends in April or June, but they're planning on giving a dividend payment of $10,000. So you want to make sure you make enough money to be able to pay that dividend. And that's an important thing. So quite an elaborate process. And that's why budgeting is so, so important. And you can imagine in a large corporation, the amount of accountants and people involved in putting this all together and the technology and the computer systems to do this. That's why we have what is called Oracle Company, which produces SAP software, which helps companies do this. Very important the Oracle brand out of San Jose, California, that puts together these software packages to help businesses put all this together and use the technology applications to put these budget planning together, and then combining it with the accounting systems, and then you can get a variance analysis. Quite elaborate. So problem 20-4 gives a nice overview of the whole budget process that needs to be done for a company. Now we're going to take a look at our final chapter, chapter 24, the capital budgeting and investment analysis. This is where it all ends up to, the finance people of a company. You can do all the budgets you want, but unless the investment in your assets is not producing a good enough return, you're not going to be in business very long. And there's a process of doing that. In these two problems on page 954 of your textbook, highlight what capital investment and the definition of capital investment is all about. How much you're going to invest in a product, what's its depreciable life, what's its salvage value, how much is it going to be worth at the end of the investment, and what type of profits and revenue and expenses is this product or this machine going to generate, and what's that return on that investment over the depreciable life. So here's a company that is going to invest in a new machine at $480,000. Oops, $480,000. It's going to have a four-year life. That's its depreciable life. That's the depreciation life of this company. And it's going to have a value at the end of those 4 years estimated at being $20,000. That's called the salvage value. It's going to generate over those 4 years annually sales of $1.8 million and these following expenses. So our job now is to take these annual revenues and expenses allocated over 4 years and prepare an investment return analysis for this $480,000 investment. Every asset purchased by a company does this process. So let's take a look at what those results look like. Okay, here, this file is located in your week review for chapter 24, if you want to take a look at this file. Here's that problem we just took a look at, where we're investing $480,000 into an asset, and it's generating sales every year for 4 years, expenses, depreciation, all right, and period cost, operating expenses, G&A. With a net accounting income of $53,900. In other words, revenue minus expenses, $53,900. That's the accounting income every year generated for this investment. The net cash flow generated from this investment is taking the accounting income and adding to it depreciation, which is $115,000. Why are we adding in depreciation? Because it's a non-cash expense. Remember, from a depreciation is an expense that you're allowed in your business to depreciate the assets, but you're not writing a check to Mr. or Mrs. Depreciation. It's a non-cash expense. So truly, your accounting income is $53,900, but your net cash flow per year is $168,900. So if I want to determine my payback method, one way of determining return on investment, I take my investment and divide it by my yearly cash flow. It's a little bit under 3 years. In other words, 2.84 years. It's taking me to pay back the $480,000 investment in year zero. It's taking me almost 3 years to pay that back. Apple Computer says we won't make an investment in an asset unless we pay it back in 2 years or less. Under that scenario, Apple wouldn't go with this. But most companies would probably approve this investment because you're still paying it back in a nice, adequate time, a little bit less than 3 years. Another way of judging investment return analysis is called the net present value method. In here, you take the yearly cash flows, remember it was $168,900 over 4 years, the depreciable life, and you discount these 4 years back at your discount rate, or given in the problem, your cost of capital, 7%. That's called your discounted cash flow. So if I go to formulas, function, financial, and look up net present value, there it is right there. That's a formula and an equation that takes my cost of capital, 7%, and then takes the yearly cash flows from year one through year four, see it there, E19, H19, and takes those cash flows and determines their present value today, year zero, $572,100. So we're actually generating over 4 years, $675,600 of cash flow. But taking into account the cost of capital, cost of money being 7%, this is actually worth $572,100 now. So the net present value is the difference between the discounted cash flow off those cash flows and the investment. A positive. So our net present value is $92,100. So we're generating in today's dollars a profit. Now we're actually making a lot more, but we're taking into account that this is a future flow of cash, and we have to discount it back at what this money is costing us. It probably, the discount rate is what it cost them to get this investment of $480,000. Cost them 7%. It's your interest expense. So now you're discounting this back here, and the net is your net present value. What is this net present value in interest or a return? That's where you use the internal rate of return analysis. Formulas, function, financial, IRR, internal rate of return. All you need to do here is take under values year zero through year four. And that comes out to an interest rate of, let's be a little bit more specific. Let's go to two decimal places, 15.23%. So this $92,100 in dollars return on investment in a percent is 15.23%. That's not bad. Now, General Electric says we will not invest in an asset unless it produces a 20% internal rate of return. So in that, this case, they will probably would not accept that project. But still, a 15% return is not bad. It's double the cost of the money. Some companies, when they're taking the investment out of their profits, they'll use the discount rate as the current inflation rate. If they're not financing this $480,000, if they already have the money and they're just going to put their retained earnings or their cash into that investment, they'll use the inflation rate as the discount rate. So this is what Chapter 24 is all about. We plan on making an investment here in this case of $480,000. Here's what we project the expenses and revenues to be. Here's what we project the cash flow to be on a yearly basis. And are we getting our $480,000 back? Yes, in 2.84 years, $92,100 profit and a 15.23% return on our investment. Any investment in assets, this analysis is being done. The key is you're going to need your accounting information to determine your accounting net income, a budgeted net income. Remember we just did capital budgets? Remember we just did the master budget? You would do a specific budget for this particular investment and use that to determine projected return. So before you even make the investment or purchase the asset, you can calculate and project these numbers saying, yeah, I think this is going to be okay. If we meet these goals, we're going to make money. And that's a key to financial and finance management in companies. Before you make the decision, is this a viable investment? Okay, now let's take a look at the next one, 24.2, which is very similar. The numbers have changed, so let's take a look at this again. Here's another project that requires, in this case, $350,000 of investment for new machinery, again, with a four-year life, seems to be a popular depreciation life, with no salvage value, nothing at its value at the end of its life, okay? So, okay. Let's determine that we have $56,000 net accounting income. And here's how we determine its return on investment. I have the spreadsheet all set up. Here in this case, the discount rate is not 7%, but it's 8%, a little bit higher cost of money. And here's our investment. Here's our cash flow every year. So we're generating off this $350,000 investment, we're generating $224,000. This doesn't look good, all right? At the same time, okay, but remember, this is our accounting income. So to this number, we have to add back in the depreciation. Remember, depreciation is non-cash. So we always have to add back in depreciation, which in this case, you're depreciating that $350,000 over 4 years. So that's an $87,500 depreciation with no salvage. So we're going to add back in the depreciation. 87.5 to our number. And there's our cash flow per year. So we'll just copy that down. So remember, the accounting income was 56,000, but we add back in depreciation. Now this looks a little better. So now we have total cash flow of 574,000. If we discount that at 8% formula function, net present value, that's the formula. Our discount rate is 8%. And our values year one through year four are 143.5. That means we're generating $475,290 in discounted cash flow. Thus, our net present value, like we did in the prior problem, is the difference. Or $125,290. This is even a better profit than problem 24.1. What's our internal rate of return? Again, another formula, IRR, remember from before. And you just take now, including year zero as a negative, what's that in a percent? Go to two decimal places. That's what I like to see, two decimals. And so there's the percentage return is even higher, 23.21%. Even Apple and General Electric would go for this one. What is our payback in years? That's all simply, it's the 350,000 divided by our yearly cash flow. A little bit under 1.5 years. Let's make that nice and neat. We'll go to two decimal places, 1.44 years. Now, the reason we can do it, 350 divided by, I put 243, that's 143. There we go. There we go. Okay. 140. Reason why I took 350 and divided by 143.55 is because it's the same amount every year. But if these cash flows were different every year, then we would have to do it over the period of time and see how much that would be in years. You couldn't do it that easily. You'd have to go year by year to determine what is outstanding and still needs to be paid back until you fully pay it back in that year. So as you can see in problem 24.2, this is a pretty good investment, even better than problem 24.1, where we had a 2.84 payback. and the discounted cash flow was about $92,000. Here in this one, it's a little bit better. So I think that's an important thing to look at. More return, a better project, a better investment. And that's what this is all about. This is the end part, the key ending part of our study of this class is now we're taking accounting information, revenue and expenses, and combining it into determined cash flow, adding back in depreciation, and using that to determine investment strategy. Will this projected accounting income and cash flow more than enough to return the investment at the investment cost, the discount rate? And will that be positive, positive dollars, positive return, payback before the end of the project's life? All those three determine the success in advance of that capital strategy. And this is how we end our course, by learning about accounting, learning about how we put this, get the numbers, how we do journal entries and transactions and prepare the financial statements, and now come to the point where we can use this data to make financial strategy looking out into the future in the form of either budgets or investment in assets and the return on those assets. These are all the common building blocks of financial management for a company. So as we conclude this week 8 lecture video, all these problems we just worked on are here in week 8, contribution margin break-even analysis, the budgeting, and the capital investment that we just did. All those files are right there so you can review them. And these are all the final questions of our examination on explaining these and understanding these things as we conclude our class. And in my video on Thursday, the concluding video, I will talk how we relate all these questions to the final examination and what I'll be looking for in your analysis of that financial information. So thank you, everybody. Any questions? I'll be around on Thursday evening. If not, send me beforehand and we'll wrap up our course this week. Thanks, everybody, and we'll see you on Thursday. Adios.